This was Abby. This was Abby. A woman loved and in love. Until that night, when something evil came looking for a soul to possess.
I can't stop thinking about your husband.
That creep. Forget him.
Was this Abby? Now the fun starts.
Grab her! Hold her! Hear me, demon. Leave this woman's body!
Abby. Rated R.
Everyone, this is Michael yet again, and thank you all for joining me this evening. This continues to be a month of horror. That's right, celebrating horror films all the month of October. And boy, do I have a doozy for you tonight. This is actually a film taken from the collection, and it's my goal to actually watch more films from the collection. I really do mean to. I have a lot of films, and most of them I'll be honest to say that I haven't seen, so I'm going back to the collection to watch some of the films that I own but have never seen. But anyway, today's film is a 1974 horror movie, Abby. As you can see here, this says collector's edition of the film itself, and that is really a joke because there's really nothing special about this edition at all that makes it collectible. So it's a pretty piss-poor release of the movie, but, I mean, you know, definitely the meat and potatoes is the film itself, but the extras really add nothing extra special to the release at all. Now, Abby is a film that is pretty closely based upon the events in The Exorcist, and I would most definitely say it was inspired by The Exorcist because we have a lady that is stricken by a demonic spirit. She tortures and frightens her immediate family. We have a godly man at the end that is there to exorcise the demon out of her. So basically, it's the same thing in terms of events, you know, demonic possession and all that that were featured in The Exorcist. But this is a black exploitation film. And it's a completely black cast for the most part. And the most notable actor in this would probably be William Marshall, who I am very much aware of. He's a great actor. He's also the actor that went on to play Blackula in the two Blackula movies. I think they were Blackula and Scream, Blackula Scream. But he plays an archaeologist and a religious man. And in this movie, he takes on the demonic force that has stricken Abby. Now, just like my last review, which was the movie Rabbit, which many of you had never heard of, Abby suffers from the same fate as that film. It's a very obscure movie, and many people have never heard of this movie. Now, with that said, it came out in 1974, and The Exorcist came out a year before them. And like I said, if I'm to be honest, it definitely is inspired by The Exorcist, and given that particular fact about the film, Warner Brothers went after the producers of this movie and they wanted it to cease and desist because they felt like it was infringing on the elements that made The Exorcist The Exorcist, and it was a copyright and story violation. So the film was immediately taken out of the theaters and Warner Brothers won the lawsuit. So this film went unseen for many, many years, and even today, there's various few copies of this movie. Rumor has it that Warner Brothers has the film locked up in vaults, and that they still have control over the movie, and so on and so forth. So, Abby is a film that you just don't really see at all anymore. As a matter of fact, I actually found this on a website entitled Oldies, I believe. And I bought this copy there because I thought, The Exorcist with a Black Cast. That sounds interesting. And throw in the black exploitation elements, and it could be an entertaining movie. The film itself was directed by William Girdler, who is probably most well known by the film Grizzly, which he directed, and then he went on to direct Day of the Animals. The movie was distributed by AIP, American International Pictures, but once the lawsuit hit, the film, I believe, had been in the theater for a month and it grossed $4 million. And given that it only cost $400,000 to make this movie, $4 million was quite a bit of money. And it would have made more if it hadn't been forced to be pulled from the theater. One of the sad things about William Girdler is that though the film was tied up in legal matters, once the lawsuit was settled, he didn't see a dime from what this movie made. The grosses that it made, he didn't get a penny because he passed on before the lawsuit was settled. And it was really, you know, a tragic affair and the end of his career. Now, granted, even William Girdler was truthful in that the film was inspired by The Exorcist, but he also said that it was inspired also by Rosemary's Baby. Now, unfortunately, Warner Brothers saw this as blatant copyright violation, and apparently the legal system agreed with them and the film was banned and Warner Brothers attained rights over the film. But unfortunately, as I said, Girdler saw no financial profit from his endeavor. The lead actress who played Abby, Carol Speed, was a pretty prolific actress back in the day. In the 70s, she made quite a few films. I am looking over her resume now, and she did make a lot of appearances in the 70s. And as a matter of fact, looking over her record, her last role was in Village Vengeance, which came out in 2006. But up to that time, she had appeared in many black exploitation movies. What's this? She also played in Sanford and Son. Wow, I did not know that. She played Crystal Simmons in the episode Here Comes the Bride, There Goes the Bride. That is a very, very good episode. I didn't know that was her, but that is really, really interesting. Now, as I said before, in the lead role, we had William Marshall, who would also play Blackula in two films. The first one, of course, being Blackula, and the second one being Scream, Blackula, Scream. And I remember the first film very, very vaguely. I saw it. I'm not for sure. It's been so long ago that if I saw it in its entirety or not. Now, that's a film that I really want to return to and watch again, and its sequel, which I've never, ever seen. But Marshall is definitely the most talented actor in this film, and he has a gravitas about him, and he has a commanding presence about him. So he's really good as the religious exorcist-type character in the film. And then, surprisingly enough, we also have Terry Carter, which many of you may not know, but most famously, I would say that he played Colonel Ty in the 1970s series Battlestar Galactica. And he actually played the husband of Abby in this movie. Now, you know, after watching this film, it's obvious that there are similarities to The Exorcist. But are there enough similarities in this film for Warner Brothers to actually leap out and sue these producers and ban this film? I don't think so. I think that, you know, perhaps in the time and the period in which this film and The Exorcist was made, perhaps, you know, films of demonic possession were pretty rare. So I can see why they felt intimidated by the movie, but at the same time, it's also very, very different from The Exorcist. And quite frankly, guys, I don't know if it's my copy of the film, which is a very, very cheap copy of the movie. This was very, very inexpensive. It didn't cost much at all. But the cinematography, the way the film is made, the look of the film, all those things, it is not even on par with the professionalism and the way The Exorcist looks. This is a very cheap looking movie, and with a budget of $400,000, which some had actually said $200,000, the film looks very, very cheap. There is very, very few locations in the movie. The acting is really not all that good, even though we have some actors that would go on to become pretty decent. But, you know, the similarities are so little. Other than the demonic possession, to me, Warner Brothers overextended themselves and jumped on this film when they didn't really need to. And given the fact that it is black exploitation, I seriously doubt that it would have reached a wide audience. So really, I think Warner Brothers were being asses to actually, you know, ban this movie and come to legal terms. Because, you know, I didn't hate the movie, but at the same time, it's not on par. Not on par at all with The Exorcist. Now, as far as the story is concerned, everybody, you know, Abby is a nice girl. The cast in this movie are very pleasant people. I mean, they're easy to watch. They're easy to root for. Abby is bubbling. She's joyful. She's a lot of fun. Definitely the heart of the movie. And she's the perfect foil for this demonic spirit to inhabit. Now, there are some oddities in this film, with the biggest one probably being that, you know, William Marshall plays the father of Abby's husband in the movie. And he's not only a strongly religious man, but he's also an archaeologist. He goes to Africa at the beginning of the movie to this burial chamber to dig up some old items. And he finds this little container that he actually opens up, and it releases the spirit of the demon. And he's way in Africa. But, you know, a few minutes later in the movie, we see this demonic force take over Abby. So it travels all the way from Africa to the U.S. to possess his daughter-in-law, which is really kind of strange. And, you know, given that this demonic spirit is locked in this vial all these years, it harbors this vengeful spirit against Abby's father-in-law. And the complexities of all this is never really explained, because you would think that the demonic force would be happy to finally be freed, but it's angry with the guy that freed it, and it's wanting to take over Abby, who's technically his daughter-in-law, but not really his family. So if it's really looking for vengeance, it's really strange how they went about doing it. And it's almost like, you know, the writers possibly couldn't think of anything else. I mean, it would have made much more sense to me to have him bring this vessel that was holding the spirit back home and then open it, versus opening it all the way in Africa and it just somehow traveling all the way to the U.S. to possess her. And the spirit of this thing is some kind of sexual demonic spirit. It's a sexual thing, and it's a trickster. It likes carnal pleasure. It wants to inhabit Abby, and basically it wants to make her have sex with everybody. That's what this demonic spirit is wanting to do. It's wanting her to just sleep with everybody. And she does sleep with a few guys in the film, despite the fact that she has a husband who, you know, is standing by her and looking for her when she just leaves the house. He wants to bring her back. He knows something's wrong with her. He calls upon his father to help him. The father leaves Africa. And he also has a friend who comes along to help him in this search for Abby and all that. So, you know, while I thought the film overall, you know, it comes across as really kind of corny and kind of cheap, I watch these films that are, you know, decades old, and I try to put myself in the mindset of when they were released, 1974. And I think about, you know, what was people were used to seeing in the theaters, how this was all kind of new. And I try to kind of approach it from that level, but it's really hard when you weren't really there and you see things that are in movies that, you know, are oftentimes very, very tame by today's standards. But you try to put yourself in their place and you try to, you know, enjoy the film on that level. But like I said, it is kind of hard. And, you know, a lot of it comes across as corny. There's definitely no terror or fright in the movie. Perhaps at the day when it was released, that was there, but definitely not there anymore. A lot of it is, you know, I found myself laughing at a lot of it because it was just funny. I mean, you know, the spirit would throw people across the room, and you could obviously see that the people were hurling themselves across the room. But I think what saves this movie for me is the fact that it's just so damn corny. It's just so corny, and it's just so different. And seeing a movie with a black cast dealing with demonic forces is just kind of, it's different. You don't see that every day. And it was just, it's just kind of funny. I think it had a decent cast. Abby, you know, really a likable person before all this happened. But as she gets possessed, she's definitely really kind of corny. She comes across as corny, unscary, and just funny the way her voice is, the way they've augmented her voice, and so on and so forth. William Marshall, like I said, the best thing about this film. Then, of course, we have Abby, the actress that played her. That would be second. But a nice family setting. Abby's mom is in this film. And it's just the kind of family that you feel like when I grew up, the kind of family that you knew. Everybody was just so friendly, and they were very, very, they reminded me a lot of the family that I grew up or at least knew when I was a kid. So it's a very, very corny film. A lot of you definitely would not like this film, and you'd probably get a chuckle from it. You're not going to find anything terrifying about this film anymore. It's more funny than anything. I laughed. There were times I laughed out loud. But, you know, looking at this film now and comparing it to The Exorcist, I don't see what the fuck Warner Brothers saw in suing these people because they felt intimidated by this movie. I mean, The Exorcist, multi-million dollar film, and then you have this film, $400,000. Come on, there's no comparison, man, other than demonic possession. But I found it entertaining, very, very entertaining. Now, it's a shame that this copy is a little more than a glorified VHS. It's not a good copy at all, and that's what I say. You know, the film doesn't look good. Now, perhaps it's because of my copy. The copy is really bad. And this film really deserves a decent release. A restoration is what it deserves because it's really kind of the first of its kind. A black exploitation film dealing with demonic possession. I think it's deserving of a quality release. And when I say, you know, this says collector's edition, I'll read you what the extras are on this. Digitally restored print, direct from film. I don't know where they're getting that from because the restoration on this fucking movie sucks like shit. Scene access, interactive menus, stereo sound, original theatrical trailer, original radio spot, theatrical lobby cards, poster gallery, rare production stills, the history of Abby, and much more. No, this don't really have much more at all, guys. And the production history is, you know, it's just text. I read it, but then when I went to click on the next frame to read more, it wouldn't even activate. I was just stuck with it. It would not move. There's the back of it. But it's a film, like I said, just for historical sake. It needs to be re-released for home video and on Blu-ray in a really quality release. But like I said, guys, doesn't compare to The Exorcist at all. Not at all. But anyway, if you get a chance and you feel like laughing a little bit, check out Abby. I'm not sure where you might be able to buy it. I do know that it seems like I looked this up on Amazon because I was curious to see if there was a better copy of it. And I think this DVD sold for like so much money that I couldn't believe it. Let's see. All right, where is Abby? This should be on here already. I've already looked it up, but I don't see it. All right, is this going to bring it up? And this isn't even bringing it up, guys. I actually saw this on Amazon before, but I don't see it now. Let's see, maybe if I put DVD behind it. And nope, not showing up at all anymore. Wow, that's sad. Well, I guess it's not available anymore. But perhaps if you're interested, you can find it on eBay or something like that, or just do a Google search. But I thought it was corny as hell, oftentimes funny when it didn't mean to be. There's really, you know, no sexual scenes and far in so much as nudity or anything like that. A little bit of cursing, you know, but nothing really extreme. And I think this might have even been rated R back in the day. What does it say on here? 92 minutes, color 1974, no rating on it at all. But, yeah, guys, it's pretty bare bones, nothing inside. That's all you get. But anyway, thanks for watching, everybody. Take care of yourselves. I am still very much aware that I have a Hammer Horror review coming up. Having to put the room together, which I finally got it together now. I got a little bit behind on everything, and I'm going to be doing the Hammer review. Not for sure when, either late this weekend, late Sunday, or sometime next week. So I haven't forgot. But anyway, thanks for watching, everybody. Take care of yourselves, and I will see you at the very next episode of A Month of Horror.